Welcome to Generations Church. What a beautiful day we have. And I say that because the sun came out there for a few minutes. It's beautiful today, but every day is a beautiful day to worship the Lord. Why don't you stand with us? Let's praise his name this morning. Good to see you. Good to have you here. We're going to hear the word of the Lord. He's going to speak to us through his word today. So, Diane.
Good morning. I'll be reading Psalms 18, 25 through 50. To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless. To the pure, you show yourself pure. But to the wicked, you show yourself shrewd. You save the humble, but bring low those whose eyes are haughty. You, O Lord, keep my lamp burning. My God turns my darkness into light. With your help, I can advance against troop. With my God, I can scale a wall. As for God, his way is perfect. The world of the Lord is flawless. He is a shield for all who take refuge in him. For who is God beside the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? It is our God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to stand on the heights. He trains my hands for a battle. My arms can bend a bow of bronze. You give me your shield of victory, and your right hand sustains me. You stoop down to make me great. You broaden the path beneath me so that my ankles do not turn. I pursue my enemies and overtook them. I did not turn back till they were destroyed. I crushed them so they could not rise. They fell beneath my feet. You armed me with strength for battle. You made my adversities bow at my feet. You made my enemies turn their backs in flight, and I destroyed my foes. They cried for help, but there was no one to save them. To the Lord, he did not answer. I beat them as fine as dust borne on the wind. I poured them out like mud in the streets. You have delivered me from the attacks of the people. You have made me the head of nations. People I did not know are subject to me. As soon as they hear me, they obey me. Foreigners cringe before me. They all lose heart. They come trembling from their strongholds. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. Exalted be God, my Savior. He is a God who avenges me, who subdues nations under me, who saves me from my enemies. You exalted me above my foes. From violent men you rescued me. Therefore, I will praise you among the nations. O Lord, I will sing praises to your name. He gives his king great victories. He shows unfailing kindness to his anointed, to David and his descendants forever. That's the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you. I say this all the time, and it remains as true as ever. God's word changes our lives. That's why we need to read it. That's why we need to make it a daily part of who we are, what we do, and why we do what we do, so that we can know the word of God, so we can speak on God's behalf, we can share our faith with lost people, and they can come to find faith in Jesus Christ themselves. Amen. That's the cycle. So that when we get that person saved, we're going to train them, and they're going to do it, and then the cycle goes, and it's an exciting thing. That's how Jesus decided to grow his church. He said it this way. He said, go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. So that it's almost a one-on-one, and it's taken centuries. But one day, how many of you know, one day, Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
Amen. That's going to be a time. So thank you very much for being here. Leave your offering at the back door when you... We're going to worship some more.
Find a hold it on with your love gone.
Worship his holy name. worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Let's sing that again. You are here. Working in this place. That is who you are. 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 Oh, you're my Lord. Oh, my promise keeper. Oh, that is who you are. Father, my love is dead. matter of fact, we give you full reign today. Make changes today in us, Lord. Oh, we love you, Daddy. We love you, Father. Use this place today. Use us today, Lord God. Speak to us today, Lord. We love you. It's in the name of your most precious Son, Jesus, that we pray today. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
Hey, good morning, church. Welcome to Generations. My name is Mason Jones. I'm your pastor's assistant this morning. Well, I got a fan, don't I? I got a fan, JJ. You got a fan. I don't know. Not that kind. Hey, well, you have a welcome card in front of you there, so utilize that. If you're new to Generations Church, let us know that as well. We do welcome you and are excited that you're here. On the back is our prayer request, so go ahead and put those down as well and put this in the basket at the end of service. These prayers do get prayed for all week long, and many of them surely get answered. And if you have a praise report, you can write it on there as well. We love seeing those too. This is our offering envelopes that are there for you. If you're a regular tender of Generations Church, we ask that you utilize that. And if you're giving to one of our ministries, mark that as well. And again, put this in the basket at the end of church. If you don't want to do them here, you can do them online at visitchurch.net. That's our website. You can check out our calendar and all the things that are going on with us here at Generations, as well as some other things that are there. So check that out sometime. And if you're not around, you can watch us online as well. So that's pretty cool. Before I get started, it is Mission Sunday, the first Sunday of the month. So I'm going to ask Bruce to come up and share with how things are going in the missions field. And so he's got a few points to share with you, so I'll let him do that, and then I'll give you some other announcements.
Thank you. Good morning. Happy Sunday. You got here before the rain. Okay, we're going to start out with a little quiz, if you're up to it. I know it's kind of early. It's before noon. How many of you have heard of or know of the slogan, Miracle on Palm Avenue? Amen. I thought so. I thought most of you knew that. But we need to be reminded now and then about it, what God has done here. Factually, and it's that mirror, that slogan or that Miracle on Palm Avenue is still alive and today and well, doing well with God's help at 6245 Palm Avenue. We've experienced God's blessings here since January 2014, and he still has his hand on this church and on us and our ministries here and reaching out to the community. That's why we're here, to share the word of God and Jesus with people around us and in 46 countries around the world through our Open Bible Global Missionaries. So on February 2nd, if you recall, if you were here, the Hunsackers, their missionaries in Mexico, were here with us, and we took an offering for them the day they were here, February 2nd, and we gave to them $1,089 for the missionaries in Mexico. Thank God. And so we thank you for generously giving to missions and to our 2019 goal, which we exceeded twice in 2019 with the helping hand of God on us. And in 2 months here in 2020, we've already exceeded our two-month amount that we need to reach 15,000 by the end of the year. In the first 2 months of 2020, we've exceeded that by $1,500. So miraculous giving in 2019 and 2020, and we're only 2 months into it. Also, this is a miraculous thing, and I hope you feel the same way. But we have received $595 from outside of this these four walls from outside of the church in February, we've received $595 for global missions. $300 was given by local businesses in San Bernardino, and $295 came in from four states around the country, and also a contribution from Rancho Cucamonga. The four states from Florida, clear across the country, from the mid part of the country, Kansas City, Missouri, from our next state over going east, Arizona, we received the contribution. And this $200 from Alaska came in about 2 weeks ago. So again, as in 2019, God has demonstrated that he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we think or ask. And he does this for us as when we're willing to give cheerfully from our hearts, he will give us the money to give. And if we give, we'll receive from God. And that is so we can receive more. And receive more, not to hold on to it, but let go of it and give it back to the ministries here and to our missionaries around the world, and he'll give us more. That's how he does things. So we can be part of that. We can lay up treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not corrupt, and where others do not break in and steal. We can lay up treasures in heaven. We can be part of God's eternal work through our missionaries, through giving in 46 countries, and be a part of the eternal work and their labor of love around the world. Just a little thing. I have this bracelet that I've been wearing for probably 2 years, and it says, "Generosity starts here at Generations Church." And all I just shared and the miracles on Palm Avenue just brings that to home and is prevalent in our life. So we thank you for giving to missions. The envelope, fourth item down, is for missions. These are the Hunsuckers that were here February 2nd that we gave $1,089 to. And just continue to give, even though we're a little above the two-month quota. Don't give up. Keep giving. And God will do another miracle by the time we get to the end of December in 2020. God bless. Thank you very much.
Yeah, awesome job, Bruce. Bruce has been doing an awesome job, and I keep saying our missions is going strong. So thank you, Bruce, for that and your passion in missions. Okay, so a few things that are going on. You can check them out in your bulletin as well. We have Bible studies. We don't talk them too much up here, but there's a men's group on Monday nights, Impact on Sunday nights, Renew on Tuesday nights. I think Women's is on Tuesday, right? Tuesday morning, and we have a Friday night in the Word study. So we got Bible studies galore, small groups. Get involved in them. There's nothing better than being in a small group and having them all support you. You can ask a lot of people around here. So we've prayed, cried, laughed. I've told terrible stories, but we have a great time. Yeah, amen. That's right. I get in a lot of trouble on Monday nights. So anyways, come check them out. In addition to that, just a reminder, golf is coming up in two Saturdays on the 14th, if you're interested in that. There's a guy with sunglasses on back there. I bet he'll be able to tell you about those, about the golf coming up. And it's $45. You can golf. You get food. You get drink. You get, what are those called? I keep forgetting. Range balls, that's it. And you can play golf more than one time around if you like. So Noah always tries to drag me out for two rounds or three rounds, and he can go forever. I can't go so much. So anyways, check that out. And then also on the 14th, if you don't want to golf, you can paint. The girls are putting on a painting party for everyone, not just girls. It's $30. There's still spots open for that. So you can sign up at the booth out here. If you are not able to afford that or know somebody's not able to, there's some sponsors that can sponsor some of those spots as well. I'm told they have childcare. It's not me watching them, but they have childcare, so don't worry about that. But you can see Diane Miller or Jennifer, or you can stop by the booth after service for that. They have a lot of fun, so they have about 40 spots, and like I said, they have some spots left for that. Hot dog man's here. Anybody need a hot dog? Thank you. Charcoal. Sorry. Hug a hot dog today. That's what that says.
So anyway, I talked to Sally last week. And her and I eat the same type of hot dog. We like them first. Who likes them first? So a professional barbecuer, I'm not going to tell you who he is. His first name is Ray. Last name I'm going to tell you, he was a member here a few years ago. He left the area and moved out of the town area. He moved into another area. So and my hat is affiliated by him.
He could print them like he prints the money.
The money is used for the upcoming Easter basket that we give away, the two baskets that we give away. And that money that we make at the market, of course, used to fill those up for the folks that are going to be a nice basket that we're going to get. Okay, so thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Ron. Get your hot dogs. Get your hot dogs. Now I'm all messed up. Let's see, what else? Oh, Night of Champions. So teenagers and breaking out kids are going to go to Night of Champions. It's $10 if you want to go, or you know a kid that would love to go. Let them know in the kids section over there. They're planning for that. As I told the first service, Jackie Slater, if you don't know who he is, he played for the Rams for a long time. He's one of the guest speakers, along with his son, who plays, I think, for the Patriots, or did play for the Patriots. Both of them were coming to talk to the kids. And they have music and all kinds of food, In-N-Out hamburgers and games and jumpers and tons of stuff for the kids. So if you know somebody, encourage them to go. And it will be, again, on the 28th. It's $10, and it's from 2 till 9 p.m. We'll leave here at the church. So you can see Shane and the group for that. Let's see. Oh, and then Shane wanted me to let you know also that they're going to have an evening at his home, which I don't even know how his house will stand up afterwards. But he's going to have some of the youth there to hang out. So that's exciting news for him. You can talk to him more about that. I'm up here representing what we call Life Adventures. We do baseball and concerts, and we've done bowling and all kinds of things like that. And if there's something that you would like to put on or know of an event we could go do, let me know. I'd be glad to work through that. Baseball will come up here in the next couple months, so you'll be hearing about that. But Paul and I started this Life Adventures thing on a whim one day. We were going to take Bob fishing, and we decided we would take everybody fishing, and we've had a lot of fun doing that for a few years. And then lastly, daylight savings time is next week. The clocks will go forward, so if you guys don't change your clocks, you'll only be here for the donuts and coffee, and you'll miss Jim's message. So so try to set your clocks ahead. And with all that said, Jim's going to tell you about a fire hydrant and a dog, so I'm going to let him go with that. And I always set him up terribly. Anyways, here's Jim.
Thank you. to us, that we can touch people's lives, then that's the objective that we have. So we're going to be talking about just some ideas on how to raise the money, because here's a truism for you. Together we can raise $100,000. One person, if we're looking to one person to do it, we're going to be disappointed, because one person can't do it, but 50 or 105 or 209 or whatever our number is, that an amount of money can be raised because we'll be working together. Here's what it looks like. You notice per week, look at the top one, it's a dollar per week. It means that you will give $4.33 a month, means that you will give $5,200 over the course of a year. And what we're going to be asking you to do in the next several days is to earnestly ask God, Lord, what part do you want our family to have in the blessing of a new fire hydrant, so that we can meet regulations with the city and with the fire department, and if a fire happens, we can spray water on it and subdue it, and we can live good. Let's look at another one. Drop down to maybe about $20 a week. That's $86 a month. That's $1,040. See, if we had how many would it take to make 100,000? 10 times? Whatever it is. And then you can even drop down to the bottom where you could give $100 a week, $433 a month, $5,200 in the course of a year. That means that 10 of those, we're halfway there. And so we can play all kinds of games with that, but what I want you to consider, one of these values or one that's not on the list, whatever, we just want to encourage one another to be a participant in this project. Where we can do it together, we can't do it without your help. And so we're going to be asking you to do that. If you have any questions about what this looks like beyond what I've shared with you, I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have, go over any unresolved concerns that you might have. But I want to reinforce this question that we want to encourage you to ask God several times over the next several days. And that question really is, Lord, what level of financial involvement do you want our family to have in this fundraiser? Ask it for yourselves, as husband and wife, as a family. And what I want to encourage you to do is make it where it costs you something, where you know, someone might be able to say, oh yeah, sign me up, I can do a dollar a week. But I want you to commit to the Lord to do $20 or $50 or $100, whatever that is, that makes it a sacrifice on your behalf. That you want God to do this miracle, and you're willing to go beyond what seems reasonable, and you're willing to allow God to give you a figure, a number that will represent your commitment to the project, your commitment to Generations Church. And in fact, let me go back two spots. It'll generate admiration for your God. God gets the glory. And that's what we want to do. So anything that you want to. And then here's what's going to happen. I see this all the time, but this is what's going to happen. Some of you, when you give, and you give sacrificially, some of you are going to get a pay raise at work unexpectedly. Now, how's that happen? God looks at you, he says, check that out, I'm going to bless them, speaks to the heart of your boss, and he calls you into his office and say, Jones, you've been doing a tremendous job. Anyone here named Jones? Okay, so you've been doing a great job, and God wants to bless you. By the way, God has blessed him in several ways with a new job recently. What the other side of what will happen is usually the amount of the new pay is higher than the amount that you gave. God just likes doing that. He just likes putting you under pressure, trusting him, and then him opening the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that you can't contain. That's what the Bible says, by the way, Malachi 3. So that we want to trust God to do the improbable so that he can do the miraculous and people's lives will be changed. Sometimes I hear people say, well, you know what, we made a commitment that we were going to give so much money, and we started thinking about it, and we knew that was going to be tough on us. So what we did is we got all of our stuff together, or most all of our stuff, and we did a yard sale. And we made almost the amount that we had pledged. And so God only had to do a little more work to make the thing come together. All kinds of things will happen to you. One of the things that I've noticed in our lives, Sally and my lives, as I thought about this again, is that God has a way of making our money last longer than it used to last because we made a commitment to him. And so there's a blessing that goes along with that. Don't ask me how it works. I just know that that's what God does. And again, there'll be all kinds of things that God does that equips you to be a participant and then watch what God does. Every day, Lord, today, I'm so delighted that I could give that much to the church. I'm so delighted, Lord, that you have committed to guide my direction. Lord, I heard you speak to my spirit that we're to give $7 a week. And so, Lord, we're going to do that. Someone else will say, Lord, I thank you that you've put a boldness in me that we could give $20 a week or $58.09. You see, whatever it is, God wants to use that amount and bless you with it. And so I'll be asking you next week how you're doing, if you can put it together. I got one in this morning at the end of first service. The family left and deposited my hand the first one, and so we're excited by that, and there'll be more. So next Sunday, come prepared to give, and if you're not ready, that's okay. Come the next Sunday after that. Just when you're comfortable with the amount of money the Holy Spirit speaks into your heart, then that's when we want you to seal the deal and say, okay, God, that's what we're going to do. Let me give you, and again, any questions you have about that, just let me know, and I'll spend time with you, whatever we have to do, so that we can experience together what God wants to do. We are in a series that we are calling, we're calling it Operation Fire Hydrant, and the subtitle of what we're calling it is, I Can Do Hard Things. You know that there are some things in life that are really hard to do. No one likes to do them, no one wants to do them, but someone has to do them. And so we're going to learn how that person can be us, that we can make a decision to do the hardest thing that we've ever imagined and watch God bless it in our lives. For example, this whole question of unforgiveness is so totally destructive to the body of Christ that the body of Christ gets robbed because someone or many someones not masquerading as a believer. They love God with all their heart, but they don't like someone who hurt them somehow, some way, some time ago. And what the hard thing that God wants you to learn how to do is he wants you to learn how to be a forgiver. You see, if you forgive the wrong that was done you, and it could be horrific bad stuff, it can be stuff that any sane person would be just devastated if someone did that to them. But it doesn't matter the height or the breadth or the size of the hurt. We have a singular job, and that singular job is to forgive that person who hurt you. How many of you have ever been hurt by someone? Let me see your hand. How many of you, maybe you don't have to hold your hand up for this one, but how many of you still harbor that resentment? Yeah. See, I just want to encourage you today. Forgive them and let God do the rest. And here's what forgiving them will do. It'll set you free. You know, anger and resentment and unforgiveness is an interesting thing. We are so angry at that person who hurt us that we don't want any good thing to happen to them. So we get excited when they have hard times. But our anger, our resentment, our unforgiveness doesn't affect them at all. We want it to. We're angry in our heart. Every time we see them, we say, one of these days I'm going to, you know how you talk like that? One of these days, I'm going to get even with them. Can I tell you the best way to get even? Forgive them. They won't know what to do with it. And they'll finally turn a corner and say, will you please forgive me? I did that. I did it on purpose. I know that it devastated you. But I now realize it was wrong. And I need your forgiveness. See, when we will ask God to set us free from the bondage, and we go out into the marketplace and we start praying for and we start blessing that person who hurt us so much, and all of a sudden your world changes and their world changes and everybody lives happily ever after. You see, I think one of the most important things that you and I can do is to be forgivers. Don't allow what someone said or didn't say, did or didn't do, to determine how you're going to live your life. You make the decision that you're going to live your life free of resentment and bondage. That when someone hurts you, you're going to forgive them. Sometimes you have to forgive them face to face. Sometimes you can forgive them over the phone. Sometimes you can just forgive them in your prayer time. Lord, I forgive Billy Bob for what he said, what he did, and I refuse to allow what he said, what he did, to determine who I become in you. And so I forgive him. I let him off the hook. Lord, he can come and go. He can do whatever he wants to do, but I will no longer be in bondage to him. See, we have to come there somehow. And when we do, it changes everything about our lives. Forgiveness is sometimes the hardest job we'll ever have. But, and here's the interesting thing. God has assigned you to that task of being a forgiver. I just want to give you kind of, against that backdrop, I want to give you kind of a summary of what we're going to be doing over the next couple of weeks. Today we're talking about you can do anything God wants you to do. Forgiveness, subtitle, forgiveness is sometimes really hard to do. It's the hardest thing you'll ever have to do. We're going to do a message that will address how we can get through life whole and how we can shield ourselves from the work of Satan as he tries to swallow our lives up and some of those kinds of things. We're going to do another series or another message on how you can learn to speak life and love into people's lives. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about how to make peace with difficult people. Anyone know difficult people? They're all over the place. They have a big house. They all house themselves together or something. So we're going to do that. So let's take a look. I want us to take a look at this question of how do we go through and actually forgive someone. We'll leave that up for a second. We can do anything God wants you to do. You can wait on God's perfect timing. That's going to be one of the messages that we give. How many of you have ever asked God to do something and God maybe impressed in your heart, yeah, I'll do that. But he kind of slow on the draw. See, I don't know about you, but I've waited for like 2 or 3 years. I didn't wait graciously. You know, like, come on, what's the apostle? But when we make our commitment to God, he's going to do it in his time, not our time. And I know that this has probably happened to you, that let's say you ask him today and it's 2 years later, suddenly you realize what just happened in your life was of God. And you say, oh, Lord, I wanted you to do this 2 years ago, but today is the perfect time for it. Thank you, Lord, for knowing and keeping track so that my life can be set free. You see, God's timing, God can do all of those things. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at a couple of thoughts, what Jesus thinks about releasing people from judgment, what James does, and one of the other biblical characters. I'll think of his name in just a minute. So let's take a look at this. Matthew 5, here's Jesus talking to the disciples. They're just getting ready to come out in the open and do the work that disciples do and learn how to follow Christ and learn how to bless people and learn how to get them going in the right direction. So here's one of the first pieces of advice that Jesus gave the church. He said, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Stop there now. Do you suppose that Jesus is on drugs or something? Where does he come from? Blessed are you when people insult you. I don't know about that one. Well, the Holy Spirit does. So he wants us to say, okay, got that one, insult. Persecute, oh man, that's even worse than insults. Okay, I got that one. Falsely say all kinds of evil against you. Yeah, Lord, those are the ones that cause so much pain in my life. But you say I got to do something with it. So, okay, I got that one. What we have to do when we hear the word of God is we have to say, okay, God, that's what I'm going to do from here on out. See, don't say, okay, yeah, sounds good. I'll get back to you on that. Just do it. Now, here's what he says to do. When these things happen to you, instead of getting, up in a roar, he says, rejoice and be glad. By the way, if you want to be a happy person, you start right there. Rejoice and be glad. Begin to train yourself to hear with the eye that you're going to do whatever Jesus says. And so he says, rejoice and be glad. The Apostle Paul said on one occasion, when things go sideways, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. James says, consider it pure joy, my brothers, when you face trials of many kinds. You see, this is not just a lightweight thing that Jesus thought of as he walked out of the house into to the backyard or something. This is a way of life. That if we're going to be Christ followers, we have to figure that out. And we have to put away everything that doesn't look like this. And make that decision that we're going to serve God, we're going to follow him, we're going to learn how to rejoice and be glad. And why should we do that? Because great is your reward in heaven. You see, the rejoice and be glad has nothing to do with the bad things. It's just bad things that happen. But here he says, rejoice and be glad because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You're in pretty good company when you look like that. So that's the first thing that we have to make a decision. If we're going to be Christ followers, we have to get that nailed down. What is the next slide? Okay. Here, the Apostle Paul penned these words in Philippians 4, verse 13. And he says this, he asks this question or makes this statement, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That means that, well, we have to ask, what does that mean? I mean, does that, for example, mean I can leap over a building in one bound? You know, Superman can do that. Can we do that? Can we fly faster than a speeding bullet? Am I more powerful than a locomotive? There's some things we can't do. But the verse says, go back to, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The good news is Jesus is probably not going to ask us to jump over a building in one leap. He's going to do something more significant, something that will change our lives and change our culture. So, we have to ask, what does that look like? And part of what it looks like is where we're going to go for the rest of our lives. What are we going to be? What are we going to become? What changes must we make? Well, last week when we were together, I shared with you, the verse was, I forgot it, so I'll tell you in a minute about that. It'll come back to me. We have to ask the question, what does that mean? And what it means is we have to come to the place where we are not calling the shots, but Jesus is. You see, if we could do all things through Christ, why would we need him anymore? Now Jesus said, I want to empower you, not giving you freedom to do whatever you want to do. I want to set you free so I can do in you what I want to do to form you so that you will be a better follower of mine. See, that's what we can do. And we can forgive people, and we can love people. By the way, that's how we make the decision ultimately to forgive people, is to love them. Jesus said, a new command I give you, that you love one another even as I have loved you. So we have to, can you imagine if Jesus and his love was stacked up here, and you know, someone else, that they can't get to the level where Jesus is. Because Jesus says, this is how I want you to be. You can do all things that I want you to do. So we have to ask that question, Lord, what do you want me to do? Lord, what do you want me to become? Lord, how am I going to do that? And God will begin to converse with you, and you'll figure out all of those answers to those questions, and you will be fit to go to and fro and talk to people about the kingdom of God. Let's take a look at 1 Corinthians 10:13. This verse is it's one of the most powerful things you'll hear. But as I say that now, God's word, any part of God's word, is the most powerful thing you'll ever hear. So here he says, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. It's common for people to be tempted. How many of you have never been tempted in something? Yeah, see, every one of us, right? So no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear. God knows you inside and out. And sometimes you hear people say, I haven't come to my office sometimes. And they say, I don't know what to do. I cannot go another minute the way this is. God needs to do something. And I say, oh, really? What do you want him to do? I want him to give me the answer. Can you handle it? Can you really hear what he's saying? And so we have to understand that God knows. He knows us top to bottom, and he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear. It'll feel like you can't take anymore. But if it hasn't been lifted, then you're not done yet. So the best thing to do is to say, okay, then I'm going to become like this. I'm going to recognize that you, Lord, are faithful. I'm going to recognize that you'll not allow me to be tempted beyond what I can bear. You're not going to stretch me out. You're not going to abandon me. You're going to resource me. You're going to get me in a place where then you can move in and release me from that bondage of whatever's going on. Because he goes on to say, but when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. God's got you covered. That's what that means. He's got you covered. He doesn't have to reinvent anything. He doesn't have to get frantic and say, oh, I miscalculated. What should I do? He knows exactly what to do. And so we have to hear him so that we can know exactly what he wants us to do. And let's look at that last question, or the last verse. Philippians 4:10 from the Message version of the Bible. I'm glad in God, far happier than you would ever guess. Happy that you're again showing such strong concern for me. Not that you ever quit praying and thinking about me, you just had no chance to show it. Okay. The Apostle Paul. I mean, you read this, And you get a sense of a guy who knows God's voice, who has already made a decision that he's going to transform his thinking, he's going to renew his thinking, he's going to enact his behavior so that he begins to live like the Apostle Paul. And his life then goes and it grows and it grows. And it doesn't matter what's going wrong in his life. What matters is his attitude toward what's going wrong. And he makes decisions to go forward. So basically, the question is not, can I do this? The question is will I do it? And so we have to make a decision. Here's a thought that I penciled in this message this morning. It says, you will either crash and burn, or you will learn that with God, you can complete the assignment. With God, you can do all things with God. And that's the thing that God wants you to know today. You can do all things with Him. So here's your assignment. Go out and change the world. You have enough information to go out and change the world. Start in your neighborhood, or starting at your place at work, or starting at someone that you see when you go to the grocery store or any other place where you go and shop, and engage that person. I was with in my little life insurance career. I have a couple of clients, and I was with one about 2 weeks ago, and so she's new, and I hardly know her, but I said something about, well, in real life, I pastor a church. Oh, really? What's the church? So I told her the church. And within there was silence. So I said, you know what I want to recommend for you? She said, what? I said, when you drive home tonight, you're sitting in your car, you're the only one there, why don't you say something like this? Jesus, I want to make certain that I go to heaven when I die. Will you forgive me of my sins? Be come into my life so I can be your follower. There's a young girl that's probably about 24 years old, somewhere around there. And so when I saw her, I actually didn't see her. I talked to her on phone about 3 or 4 days later, and the weekend had come and gone. And she didn't say anything about it, so I said, what did you do on your way home 3 days ago? She said, I did it. You invited Jesus into, yes. She seemed to be very excited. People want to know how to get saved. They really do. They want to know. They want to know how to get saved because they know that there's something they don't know about what happens to their lives if they don't. And so we can just throw something against the wall. Hey, on your way home, what about you saying this? I mean, that's probably the easiest it's ever been for me to share my faith with someone and to get a response like that. The whole conversation didn't last 60 seconds. You can do a lot in a minute. So Jesus is saying, go out and do your job. Father, we want to give you thanks today. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your purpose in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in us in preparing us to be better followers. Lord, that you are resourcing us with insights and understandings, areas of our life where we need to make some radical changes, where we need to make that decision to move away from this, to move toward this, so that we can be who you want us to be and we can do the job that you've sent us out to do. And so, Lord, we give you praise today for everything that you have taught us already. And Lord, by the work of your Holy Spirit, would you make sure none of us get off the hook, that we can think of all kinds of things, but Lord, I prefer that you would help us keep our mind on you so that we can do the job that you've called us to do. And we want to just rejoice in advance because, Lord, you are an amazing God, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. Ushers are in position to receive an offering. We want to receive our offering today. I want to tell you how much we appreciate you and your giving, your commitment to Generations Church. Without you, we're nowhere. And so we thank you so much for your faithfulness and the commitment that you have. Father, we thank you for this offering today. We thank you, Lord, that you don't need the money. You need our hearts. That's what you're after. And so, Lord, we hear what you're saying, and we give ourselves to the sharing of what you have blessed us with, and we give you thanks in advance for the blessings that are still out there that you're just now starting to bring in. So, Lord, we ask that you would continue to require more and more of us so that we can touch more people and we can experience the thrill of someone finding eternal life through Jesus Christ, and now they're heaven bound. Thank you for all of that, Lord. We give you praise now in Jesus' name. Amen.
We thank you again for this day and this place, Lord. We do thank you that we can do all things through you, Father God. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for blessing generations, Father, and help us to continue to impact our community so that we can further your kingdom. We love you. In your name we pray. Everybody said, fist bump somebody on the way out.